Hello, everyone. This is Terry with Futures.io. And as always, I would like to thank you for joining us today. It's my pleasure to welcome Dave and John from the CME for today's webinar, Introducing Ether Futures. This webinar is sponsored by Iron Beam Futures. Throughout the webinar, if you have a question, please feel free to type them in the questions box. We'll do our best to answer them at the end of the event. This webinar will be recorded and posted on the Futures.io website within 24 to 48 hours. If you're watching afterwards on YouTube, please do us a favor and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed the webinar. As always, please feel free to share, comment, subscribe to our channel. It really helps us a lot. For trading news, events, and information, follow us on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitter using @futures.io. I also want to take a moment to welcome our newest webinar host, Shane, who will be taking over the webinars next week. Welcome, Shane.
Thanks, Terry. It's good to be here.
Absolutely. All right, and without further delay, I'll hand it over to Dave and Mike. And Dave, you'll get the pop-up to share your screen.
Thanks for having us. I think Dave's going to take over, but just want to say thanks everyone for coming out, and thanks to CME for presenting. And also, I think we're going to do a Q&A at the end, so stick around for that.
All right, looking good. She's all yours, Dave.
All right, so you can see the slide, then you can all hear me.
Yes, sir.
All right. Excuse me. We're good to go then. All right. On behalf of the CME Group and myself, I want to thank Ironbeam and Futures.io, obviously, for the chance to do this webinar. This is the first one that I'll have done on Ether. I got a whole bunch of them over the next couple of weeks and stuff like that. It's very exciting to see what's going on in the cryptocurrency landscape. The build out certainly continues with derivatives and options and futures, and just what's going on in the overall cryptocurrency market is just in some ways mind-boggling, but you know, some ways totally understandable given you know, fiat currencies and how gold interacts with inflation and things like that. But anyways, I'm Dave Lerman. I'm the director of education at the CME Group. We'll get into all these things and more. This webinar will go roughly 40-45 minutes, and then we'll allow some time for Q&A. Might go a little longer than that. It depends on how much time I spend on certain slides. So let's get going. All right, first quick disclaimer, neither futures trading nor swaps trading are suitable for all investors. Each involves the risk of loss. So do your homework, especially with cryptocurrencies. Later on, we're going to talk about the volatility in Bitcoin and the volatility in Ether. And you're going to see with this kind of volatility, you better do your homework because these things move a lot. You think GameStop stock moves a lot? You should see some of these cryptocurrencies intraday moves. They're amazing. All right, so Ether and the growing cryptocurrency landscape. All right, so on the heels of we have a great launch back in 2017. To launch a product that had, you know, 120% volatility was very, you know, it's risky. People tend to trade. They like to trade volatility. They like big swings in the market. But, you know, sometimes it gets a little bit too much and the clearinghouse has to charge a lot of margin. And we had like 30%, 35% margins. But still, it was a successful contract. We're doing about 10,000 a day now. We'll go over a little bit of, even though this is an Ether webinar, we're going to go over some of the highlights of Bitcoin a little bit and then graduate into Ether futures and what's going on. We plan to launch February 8th. Of course, that's subject to regulatory review, and we should get it. That should be no problem. Average daily Bitcoin volume was about 10,000 contracts a day in the fourth quarter. December and January have been incredible for cryptocurrencies, the options on the future. The price action is unprecedented. I think in 2020, Bitcoin and other cryptos, they advanced by triple digits. No other asset class did that. As good as the stock market was, as good as small cap stocks did, as good as gold did. Gold was up 20%. Some of the cryptos were up 150 to 200%. Will that continue? Time will tell. I won't say yes or no because nothing surprises me these days. So we saw unprecedented volatility. So the Merc made the decision that, you know what? We have Bitcoin, we have futures on the largest of the cryptocurrencies, time for the second largest, which is the Ethereum blockchain, and obviously the currency that is generated to pay the fees and the transaction fees in the Ethereum blockchain is called Ether. It comes from Ethereum. So Bitcoin, so futures contracts on Ether and Bitcoin will provide investors with tools for risk management and also speculative tools and things like that. And it's also, we're going to get into how a hedger may use these things, how speculators may use these things. And there's a lot for everyone out there. Just a quick evolution, because it certainly has been an evolution. You know, I gave the product launch seminars for Bitcoin futures back in December of 2017. And it's been an incredible run. but also it was new. It's totally new. Bitcoin, you know, had only been around about 8 years, 7 or 8 years. Not too many people had heard of Ethereum or Ether, and you know, the crypto landscape grew from a couple of dozen cryptocurrencies to like 2,000 or 3,000 overnight, it seemed. But let's see how we got there. First of all, we have the Bitcoin reference rate in 2016. Now, some people may say, "What? Who cares about this? Who cares about the reference rate on Ether dollar, Bitcoin dollar reference rate?" You better care. You have to care because this is what gives legitimacy to the market. This is what gives tightness to the market and robustness to the market. Anyone ever wonder why the S&P 500 is so successful? Well, obviously, you know, there's a lot of people interested in trading the stock market as a whole. So the S&P 500 being the key benchmark stock, it's your reference rate, believe it or not. And then look at it another way. Reference rates are, you know, kind of like the London gold fixing that happens every day. All right, so you need a reference rate, you need real-time indexes, and the S&P 500, there's a lot of reasons why it's liquid, but it's liquid because there's a cash market that's calculated, and it's very robust. It's so robust that so many people calculate it that anytime there's a little minor error, some firm will come up and say, hey, there's a little error, you're off by 0.01 or 0.02 or 0.10 points or something like that. That happened once. We settled the S&P 500. We were off by one basis point. And one of our market maker firms said, there's a mistake. And this is the robustness of reference rates and cash markets. And if you want a really good futures market, it helps to have a large underlying cash market. Well, the underlying S&P 500 has a very large underlying market. We hope to replicate the same thing in the cryptocurrency space. So we started in 2016 calculating the Bitcoin reference rate. And we'll get into how reference rates are calculated along with the real-time indexes and stuff like that. So that started in 2016. We actually launched Bitcoin futures in 2017. Then came, you know, we had some good success with Bitcoin, and lately we've had great success. And then in 2018, we started the Ether dollar reference rate, just like Bitcoin, but it tracks Ether, a reference rate, all right? It's, like I said, the London gold fixing rate. It's kind of like that, akin to that. Then we launched Bitcoin options early last year in 2020. We've done well. It takes a little bit longer to develop options markets. You need more market makers. You need more pipes. You have tremendous volatility. And the whole liquidity thing is just different. When we launched Eurodollar futures, they became successful. It took about 5-10 years. Eurodollar options weren't doing so well, but now they're one of the largest, most liquid options on futures contracts in the world by far. And now February 8th is when we're planning on launching Ether futures in 2021. So we'll have a robust real-time index. We'll have a robust reference rate based on the Ether dollar reference rate. And it'll help people get a really good feel for where the market should be trading at or approximately. Okay. And this is, again, pending regulatory review. So a little progress report on Bitcoin. So in January of 2021, the month just ended, we did about 16,900 contracts, average daily volume. That's about 84,000 equivalent Bitcoin, and that's up 57% compared to January 2020. Average daily open interest is about 11,000. For the fourth quarter, we did almost 10,000 contracts. Average daily open interest is around 11,000. For the full year in 2020, we did about 8,700 contracts, and the average daily open interest is 8,600. Another interesting thing in terms of other highlights, trades originating outside the United States, 44% in futures and only 11% in options. The number of accounts trading is a highlight. When you have 7,200 futures contracts, this is new futures contract accounts trading Bitcoin. That's incredible, 190 in options, which makes sense. It's 3 years. It was only launched in 2020, not 2017. So to jump up to 7,200 accounts trading Bitcoin in just 3 years, that's pretty good. Again, there's a lot of people that just don't understand. We're early in the game. We're probably, when I first gave the first seminar, I said, we're in the first inning, second inning. I think we're moving along now in the third or fourth inning. There's still not US-based ETF that I'm aware of. There's the Grayscale Bitcoin Trust, but that's a trust that's a little bit different. It's priced crazily. It's got a huge premium, although I think that's come down a little bit. And the landscape's nowhere near complete, but the CME, in terms of futures and options on futures, is making its contribution to the cryptocurrency landscape for sure. Whoop. All right, so here's the interesting thing. I always like putting the next two charts up. It shows cryptocurrency landscape in relation to other assets. And I remember when I did this, again, this seminar, I had these up here. The numbers were much, much different. Apple wasn't a $2 trillion company. The gold market cap was only around $8 trillion. All the cryptocurrencies were barely 200, 300 billion. Now they're 953 billion. They're probably closer to a trillion now. And Bitcoin is now 644 billion. It's 2/3 of all the crypto market cap. It was about 125, 150 billion back when I first started doing these. Jeff Bezos, 183 billion. And Ethereum, 124 billion. So there you see the two large ones, Bitcoin and Ethereum, along with some other things, just to give you a little idea of where cryptocurrencies stand. Again, they're making great progress. They're still, you know, kind of relatively small relative to gold, relative to the S&P 500. But remember, this whole thing, Satoshi, the guy that Satoshi Nakamoto, whatever his name was, or that's a pseudonym anyways. No one knows who invented Bitcoin. That's just a fake name, believe it or not. And some people think they know who Satoshi is, but no one's ever come forward and proved it. But you can see just amazing growth. The next one is top 10 cryptocurrencies. This is just cryptocurrencies by market cap. So we've launched Bitcoin in 2017. Now we're going to launch Ethereum or Ether, which is the actual currency that you pay for transaction fees. Tether, XRP, Polkadot, Cardano, some very strange names for these things. But you can see the market caps go down precipitously after Bitcoin and Ethereum. But again, the landscape is growing and growing and growing, and who knows where Bitcoin will, what will be worth a year from now. It'll be interesting to track this. All right, so a couple more things on Bitcoin, then we're going to cover just Ether. But that's since launch in December 2017. That's a very nice chart. Gives you all the records, the open interest. It shows the average daily volume and open interest in time, and it's just incredible growth, and we look for it to continue. I think, you know, people are saying, you know, crypto like Bitcoin and Ether will replace gold as your inflation hedge or your store of value. It's like, I think you're going a little too far. That's just my opinion. I think gold's, you know, there's still, you know, advantages to owning, you know, gold as not a necessary inflation hedge, but a store of value, and it's transportable. Cryptocurrencies have all that too. You know, you can bring them anywhere you want, as long as you have a wallet or a futures account, and it's amazing. So, but this is fantastic growth. It could be just the very beginning. We could look back a year or two from now and all these volumes double and triple. It'll depend on a couple of things like, you know, the market participants, you know, how the world goes, how fiat currencies perform, how much money printing there is. I mean, there's a lot that goes into this. The thing about crypto, and this has become more important in the last 2 or 3 months, it was mostly retail or hedge fund or market maker, and it was all speculative. Games changed. The game has changed. We now have institutions. Some of them are large. We have corporations in their treasury department and taking their cash, and instead of investing in treasury bills that now yield about 4 basis points, they put it into cryptocurrencies. Michael Saylor from MicroStrategy put $245 million into Bitcoin. And that, you know, as he was one of the early in the game. Can you imagine if some of the cash balances in the treasury of Apple or Microsoft or Berkshire Hathaway would make its way into cryptocurrencies? You could conceivably see cryptos, you know, I when I heard the first prediction of $40,000 for Bitcoin, I laughed. Well, we hit it. So very interesting. So this this chart shows the number of large open interest holders. Large open interest holders are those that hold more than 25 contracts. So that's growing. And when you're holding more than 25, you're probably not a you know, a small speculator. You're more, you know, you have a little bit more financial wherewithal. And some of these institutions are starting to go public with, you know, the fact that they're investing in Bitcoin. All right, so let's compare Bitcoin and Ether. Bitcoin, simple, available supply, 18.6 million. We've all heard this, that there's only 18.6 million Bitcoin, and that's it. No, there'll be no more after work. The proof type, it's a proof of work. When you solve the problems, you get paid in Bitcoin, you can prove it. You have to prove it to the entire blockchain, which is thousands and thousands of computers talking to each other. It's got an algorithm. SHA-256, there will be a quiz on this. It stands for secure hash algorithm. It's just the type of algorithm to make the blockchain work. All right. But it's peer-to-peer technology, operates with no authority, no banks. Issuing of Bitcoins is carried out by the network. All right. Ethereum's a little bit different. It's a decentralized platform like Bitcoin. It runs smart contracts. So its applications are run exactly as they're programmed, no possibility of downtime, censorship, fraud, or third-party interference. In the Ethereum protocol and blockchain, there's a price for each operation, and this is what makes Ether, okay? The general idea, in order to have things transferred or executed by the network, you have to consume or burn gas. Now, for those of you that understand chemistry, which is few of you, I used to be a biochemist, so Ether is a gas. So it's interesting, they would say Ethereum and then Ether, a gas. The cryptocurrency or gas is called Ether and is used to pay for computation time for transaction fees. So that's how you get paid in Ether and how you get transactions done. And this all has to do with decentralized finance, which is DeFi. And currently there's about 200 major DeFi projects going out there. You could see the supply of Ethereum or Ether is 114 million. So quite a bit more than Bitcoin, but the price is different too. So in the proof type, it's proof of work. When you do Bitcoin, you have to prove your work. You have to prove you've solved something to the entire network. That's what P of W, it's proof of work. But Bitcoin's or Ethereum, Ether is going to change to a proof of status. In other words, the more Bitcoin you have, the more status you have, or the more Ether you have, excuse me. And that change is coming really, really soon. And there's going to be several changes from now till 2022. Algorithm, well, you can get into that later. You can read that. I make my presentations available on anyone, so you can read them later on and study up on some of this stuff if you're interested. There's a few more comparisons there. Satoshi Nakamoto is the gentleman that wrote the paper back in 2008 on Bitcoin, and he was the original Genesis block that was mined. He was the first miner, so to speak. I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right. Vitalik Buterin is, I think, East European or Russian, one of those, and he's the one that came up with Ethereum. Brainchild, very, very young guy, mathematical whiz, computer whiz, and came up with Ether. And so that's about it for the fundamentals underlying. If you ever want to know the correlation, people want to know this because they may spread one versus the other. There are a lot of active spread traders in commodity futures, you know, the S&P versus the Russell, gold versus silver, Brent crude oil versus WTI crude oil. Well, people would spread Bitcoin versus Ether, although it's going to be a very volatile spread. But this is the correlation between the two, and it used to be negative. You can see from 2016 to 2018, it was negative to very, very slightly positive. And then it grew, it got up to about 70 or 80%. So starting in the middle of 2018, they track each other, you know, pretty decently. That's not a 99% correlation by any means, but they tend to go up and down in concert now a little bit more than they used to. All right, so what are the benefits of trading a futures contract on Ether? Same as futures contract on just about anything. You get efficient exposure. It's very easy to buy a futures contract. All right, very simple. All you need is a futures account, and you can buy or sell Ether futures. So you could take risk, you can hedge risk, you can do all that kind of thing. You have price discovery, so we have the reference rates, okay? We have the underlying reference rates, we have the underlying real-time index that's calculated, so price discovery will be a little bit more efficient, okay? And you have capital efficiency with cryptos, all right? You'll never have to put up the full amount. Now, cryptos are volatile. As a result, the clearinghouse, the CME Group clearinghouse, is very much into risk mitigation, which means if something's moving around a lot, the margins are going to be higher. When volatility settles down, margins tend to go lower. So the early days of Bitcoin, the margins were like 37%. Most margins are under 10%. A lot of them are under 5%. This is what happens when you have 120% volatility, which we did in Bitcoin in the early days. Oh, by the way, the volatility in Ether is about 140%. So look for, pretty substantial margins. But it's to protect you, it's to protect the FCMs, the future commission merchant, and it's to protect the whole system. You don't want to be trading ridiculous, half a percent leverage, basis points leverage, 1% leverage. You want to have a stake in the game, so to speak. All right, so here's the contract specs for the upcoming launch. Again, subject to regulatory review. They make me say that at least three times in every webinar. And it's true, we've never not been approved for a contract to launch, but you never know. So the contract unit's 50 Ether, all right? Remember, Bitcoin's 5 Bitcoin, this is 50 Ether. So the ticker symbol will be ETH. The price quotation is gonna be in US dollars and cents per Ether. So right now, Ether's trading around 1650, so it's gonna be priced in dollars. The trading hours are the same as Bitcoin, the same of all our other things. It's basically when our Globex is open for trading, which starts on Sunday at 5 o'clock p.m. Central Time and goes all the way till Friday at 4 o'clock with a 60-minute break beginning at 4 o'clock every day for system uploading and downloading and maintenance and things like that. The minimum price fluctuation or the tick is going to be a quarter point, which will equal $12.50. So that's pretty small. I don't know what the market's going to be. I know we're going to have market makers to help establish liquidity. But a quarter of a point, given the $1,650 price tag, it'll be interesting to see if it's one tick, two ticks, three ticks, or whatever, if it's full points. But either way, tick is a quarter of a point, and that's $12.50. We'll have six contract months, including two December contracts. So the nearest two Decembers. The final settlement will be the last Friday of the contract month, just like Bitcoin is. And it will terminate at 4 p.m. London time, which I believe is 10 o'clock London time on that last Friday of the contract month. Final settlement delivery is cash settlement. All right, you don't get Ether, you get cash. It's settlement. So deliveries by cash settlement in reference to the final settlement price, and that's equal to the CME CF. CF stands for crypto facilities, the Ether dollar reference rate on the last day of trading. So that reference rate we've talked about is how they settle the contract. And the reference rate is a very robust calculation from some of the major exchanges and major players in the industry of cryptocurrency. Oh, here you go. So we're going to talk about a little bit, and then we'll start moving along a little faster. But we have the reference rate, the Bitcoin Ether. Excuse me, I keep saying Bitcoin, the Ether US dollar reference rate. It aggregates the trade flow of the major spot exchanges during a specific calculation window. And it does this, it does it once a day, and it comes up with a reference rate in the US dollar price of Ether. All right. And it usually is published between 4 and 4:30 London time, which is between 10 and 10:30. Central time, Chicago time. And it's for maximum transparency and replicability. And this is the thing, if you have transparent, the S&P 500, when they do the calculation, it's totally transparent. Everybody can see the calculation and everybody can replicate it. If you have, you know, the algorithms and you have the math capabilities, which is not hard, it's just a giant spreadsheet. You can calculate the S&P 500 all by yourself if you want. But that's it. We need transparency. That's what makes the market, that's what gives credibility to the markets. So that's the reference rate. That would be akin to the London gold fixing. And then there is the real-time indice, or the real-time indice, we call it the RTI. That takes the buy and sell into consideration of the order book of four or five major exchanges out there. So for Bitcoin, we've done it on Bitcoin. You can see the calculation every day, the reference rate for Bitcoin and the real-time indices. And we're gonna do that for Ether too, as we mentioned a couple times. It's geared toward low latency and timeliness, and it's based on forward-looking input data. So it would be published approximately once per second every day, including weekends and holidays. The interesting thing about Bitcoin and Ether is that every time I look at for a quote, it's always trading. I don't think this thing's down ever. It's pretty incredible. Now, there's a little bit of downtime in futures. That's just the way it is because of system uploading and downloading. We don't trade on Saturdays, but believe it or not, we catch up pretty quickly when we reopen. All right. So the RTI, the real-time indices, is akin to the S&P cash calculation, and that changes like every second. Every time there's a change in a component of the S&P 500, it updates the actual cash index, and that's what the Ether US dollar real-time index calculates. So the reference rate, think of that as the London gold fixing. It's a fixing, but not for gold, but for Ether. And the real-time index is like the underlying cash market, and it takes from four or five or six, you know, Coinbase, Gemini, all the major cryptocurrency exchanges, and consolidates the order book into one number, and it's calculated every second. All right. And there it is. Here it is on our website, but believe it or not, this shows Ether. This is a couple days ago. It's January 25th. So you can see these things are so volatile. Updating them is just hopeless. Ether's now trading at about 1650. It was 1424 when I put this page up. I wanted to update it, but I had a couple other seminars to do this week, so I couldn't. But you can see the reference rate, 1424.70. Okay, again, that like that London gold fixing that comes out at 10 o'clock, pretty much between 10 and 10:30 every day, Chicago time. And there's the real-time index, 1357.54. Remember, they're going to be different because they calculate different things, all right? Just like the price of gold fluctuates during the day after there's a London gold fixing. Gold can continue to fluctuate after that, all right? But you can see this in real time on our website, and I'm certain that the quote vendor systems will have it too. All right, a couple things about trading cryptocurrencies on the spot market versus doing it on a CME Group futures. Wallet requirement. No, when you do futures, no wallets necessary. That's the great thing. We've all heard the story about we've heard a lot in the last couple of months about the gentleman. Well, there's two great stories. One had his wallet on his hard drive, and he threw it away because the amount of Bitcoin on it at the time was worth only, you know, a couple of dollars. Well, it turned out that was worth $24 million or $240 million at some point. And he went, look, if you want to try to get an injunction to check the landfill to find the hard drive that had his wallet. And to no avail, I don't think he's found it yet. Then another gentleman, too, he just forgot his password. And you get 10 attempts. He's gone through 8 of them. And he's got about $270 million worth of Bitcoin that he got a long time ago, 7,000 coins. They were worthless a long time ago, basically. And now they're worth hundreds of millions of dollars, and he cannot remember his password, and he's got 2 more shots at it. Great thing about futures, all you need is a futures account, no wallet. So that's a good advantage. Although, you know, if you want to do secure transactions around the world, you're going to have to probably do it through a wallet, although the cryptocurrency landscape is developing dramatically. The delivery methods for Bitcoin and using them as a mode of transaction, is going to be quite amazing. I mean, just think of it this way. Visa and MasterCard each are accepted at like 40 million places around the world. Bitcoin's maybe 400,000 or a couple million or something like that. That's going to change. And the more places it will accept it for payment, you know, the better it'll be. The thing is, it's so volatile. People are going to have accounts receivable. They're going to, you know, could go up 30% in one day. Can you imagine the Treasury Department trying to figure that all out? Well, that's why we have futures. You can hedge that exposure. Capital efficiencies, leverage with futures, yes. In the spot market, no. You've got to put up the full amount of money unless you have a really, really good relationship with a bank or an investment bank. Regulated. We're regulated by the CFTC, the NFA, and we have a surveillance and compliance department, and the clearinghouse helps regulate margins too. So that's very important, especially in something that moves at 140% annualized volatility. There's some regulation in the crypto spot market, but not like futures. Potential tax efficiencies, yes, depending on the type of investor you are. If you're an active retail investor, you would get 60-40 treatment on a futures contract. If you're like a tax-exempt pension fund or foundation, no. And no tax efficiencies on Ether in the spot market. Clearinghouse risk mitigation? No, not at all on the spot market, but we have it in the futures market. Underlying a business experience, futures exchange, the Merck has been around CME Group for about 180 years, nearly 2 centuries. Spot market's been around for less than a decade or about a decade now. Ability to go short, very simple in futures, not as easy in the spot market. You can do it, but you better have some money and contacts. All right, so here's some of the price action just for the last 6 months ending January 26th. And you can see that big jump up there from 600 to this chart, it's at 1352. Well, we're at 1650 now, but let's use the numbers on this chart to make it simple. So at current prices, what will the notional value be? Well, the contract's worth 50 Ether. It was trading at the time of this chart, 1350. Just multiply the two and you get 67,500. It's probably closer to 80, 85,000 now, given that we're at 1650. 1650 times 50 is, I think, 82,500. So they'll give you an idea. It's a normal size futures contract. There are futures contracts that are worth, you know, the S&P, pit traded S&P is a $950,000 contract. It's probably nearing $1 million now with the stock market rising so much in the last week. But it's very simple. Let's multiply 50 times whatever Ether's trading at. Here's a long-term price action. You can see major double top for you technical analysts out there. We topped out back in 2017, just like Bitcoin at 1400. We rallied all the way back to 1400, stuck around there a little bit, consolidated. And then a couple of days ago, we went from 1400 to where we stand now. We made it to 1700 intraday yesterday, but I think we're at 1650 now. So we broke it above this double top for you technical analysts there. So some definite, you could see from the chart, a lot of trading opportunities here, both long and short. What's very interesting about the cryptocurrency landscape is back in 2017, that was a parabolic move from basically nothing up to 1,400. Usually when you correct off a parabolic like that, a major uprise, you don't make new highs in a couple of years. But this did, which goes to show that something's different about the crypto. You know, I'm not saying this time it's different. I will never say that. but it's interesting because usually it takes decades to work out of a parabolic top like that. But in this case, it only took about 3 years to make a new all-time high. And Bitcoin did it also. Same thing. It made a new all-time high and it doubled over its previous all-time high. It topped out at 20,000 back in 2017, made it to 41,000. So never say never when it comes to the crypto landscape. All right. And there's Bitcoin too, going back 5 years. And you can see we broke above its double top of 20,000 and we kept on going all the way to 41,000 or 42,000 intraday. Ether has done really well versus other asset classes. Actually, many cryptocurrencies have done well versus other asset classes. You can see it's not even close. 487% in 2020 versus, you know, Amazon versus Google. People say, oh yeah, Amazon did really well. Apple did really well. Gold was up 20%. Well, Ether was up 487% according to Crypto Review. Bitcoin was up, I think, it says on this chart 321. I have conflicting numbers, but it was triple digits. Let's put it that way. All right, risk mitigation and clearing, very important part. I have to make sure we go over this. So we got this great volatility and investors are curious about what this volatility, what is the CME doing to mitigate this risk? Well, we have the clearinghouse and for basically two centuries, we've been dealing with the risk of futures markets. So Bitcoin's no different. It's just a little higher volatility, all right? During the crash of 87, the Russian debt crisis, Lehman Brothers, Bear Stearns bankruptcies, the whole financial crisis of 2008, Brexit, the Swiss National Bank problem in 2013, during a host of stresses in the financial market, the clearinghouse has done well. I won't say they come through with flying colors, but they did very, very well transferring the money, making sure credit accounts were debited and credited accordingly. The clearinghouse also has the power to, you know, they can assess additional margins. They can raise their margins. They can raise them several times a day if they want, all right? So we have the SPAN margining system and it's used by dozens of exchanges around the world. SPAN stands for Standard Portfolio Analysis of Risk. And we're going through a new update of SPAN and it's gonna be released this year, I believe, all right? We got a lot of trade matching system safeguards built in. We have velocity logic and stop logic. Boy, if they only had that for GameStop, we would never have seen all the well, you would have seen volatility, probably not as much though, but velocity logic and stop logic helps prevent some of these price vacuums that occur where we have big giant drops and then huge advances in just a couple of seconds. In the early days of Globex, we had some of these price vacuums. So they put in what's called velocity logic and stop logic, and they're activated during these volatile times and they really help. It makes the, you know, it just gives a more sense of logical price movement. It bears resemblance to the cash market and things like that. So you'll will be margin offsets too. Ether investors will enjoy margin offsets with Bitcoin futures. So if one did want to spread Ether versus Bitcoin, you would get some margin offsets. I don't know how much they're going to be. Margins are coming out any day now, and as soon as we know them, you'll know them. Here's historical volatility of Ether. Pretty amazing. Look at the tops there. Oh, all over triple digits. I'll give you more detail in a second here, but back in 2018, it got up to 135%, got up to almost 155% just earlier in the year. And now it's approaching its all-time high of about 160%. Absolutely incredible. This is historical volatility, by the way. We don't have any options on it, so there's no implied volatilities, but let's put it this way. They will be high, all right? So let's drill down a little bit. I took the numbers from this chart. This is from Bloomberg, and you can also get them sometimes off of our QuickStrike tool. But I took those numbers that created that chart and created volatility percentile rankings, which anyone that's seen any of my options, webinars or seminars, you know that I like volatility percentile rankings because it kind of grades volatility. So volatility, the highest that's ever been. And there's a little date problem there. This is the date range as of 3 years ending January 25th, 2021. And this is what Ether prices at 1,320. All right. So they're 300 points higher, but the volatility, the highest it's ever been in the last 3 years, is 157%. So that's the high. 117% represents the 90th percentile, which means 90% of the time volatility is lower than 117%. 10% of the time volatility is higher than 117%. And so on and so forth. 100% volatility is the 75th percentile. It's amazing. The 50th percentile is 85%. The lowest it's been is 42%. 42% is usually, and that's the low for Ether. 42% is higher than just about 90% of the commodities out there. There's very few commodities or futures contracts that trade at 42% volatility. The currencies don't, gold doesn't, silver might be approaching it after the moves of the last couple of days. The grains, energy, they're not at 42%. They sometimes are, but that's a pretty high volatility for the low. But I wanted to convert, but I wanted people to have an idea. If you're going to trade this contract, you should have an idea of how much it's going to move. So I took a little bit of math. It's very simple math. I took the volatility and converted the volatility to a daily volatility. So at 157% volatility, that's an annualized number, every day you're going to move 10%. You got that? 9.8% is almost 10. At 117% volatility, you're going to move 7% every day. So a one standard deviation move, all right, go over into the columns now. We're in the fourth column. Takes into account 2 out of every 3 moves. So if we had 100 days of trading, 2 times out of 3, you'd have a one standard deviation move or tighter. Two standard deviation moves, a move greater than 2 standard deviations moves 1 time out of 20. And a 3 standard deviation moves 1 time out of about 200 trading days. You don't often get 3 standard deviation moves. You get them once, twice a year, or once a year, once every other year. And you can see at that high, 157%, every day you're going to move 10%, which means a 1 standard deviation move is going to be 129 Ether points. A 2 standard deviation move, 258 Ether points. A 3 standard deviation move, 388. Just to give you an idea, when volatility is really, really high, you're going to see Ether moving 100, 200, 300 points, almost 400 points. Don't let it surprise you. And these numbers will change as Ether goes up or down too. I just wanted a snapshot here. Even in the low volatility, okay, let's take the 25th percentile, 70%. It's going to move 4% a day. How often does the U.S. stock market move 4% a day? Almost never. It rarely happens. So 4% a day, you're talking a 58, 116, 174 Ether point move per day. That's amazing. And that's at a low volatility. Low volatility being 70%. That's incredible. Ultra low volatility, 42%, the lowest it's been, 34, 68, and 102. So again, I put this grid up, not to dazzle you with numbers, but just to give you an idea of how this thing's going to trade. It's going to move. It's going to move, and people like that. Traders love movement, and boy, you will not be disappointed in the movement in this contract. All right, a couple things now regarding Bitcoin and Ether, the investor ecosystem and potential uses. Whether you're a pension fund, hedge fund, prop firm, you're a miner or a corporation, there's a use for the cryptocurrency landscape, which is why this thing is attaining some critical mass now. Pension funds can use it for asset allocation, diversification. They can use it to hedge some of their holdings too. If they have a lot of currencies that are going down in value, depending on which currencies. Some of the cryptos have done very well when the currency markets have been bombed and gold gone up or, you know, whatever, although it's starting to detach from gold a little bit. Gold got creamed today. Hedge funds do long short strategies. They also hedge. Prop firms are mostly market makers and speculative. They do long short strategies secondarily. Retail active traders, mostly long short, mostly long. I don't know too many retail folks that are short this stuff. Hopefully not too many. You can do it in combination with options too. Options traders do long, short. They do income strategies, options writing, and all sorts of other strategies too. Bitcoin miners can hedge their portfolio of Bitcoin. So can Ether. If you have a large store of Ether, you can hedge using the Ether futures. Corporations, well, they can hedge receivables in Ether or Bitcoin. They can use it for treasury management, like certain companies have done, like MicroStrategy now. So also there's borrowing and lending platforms, there's hedging and position management, there's digital finance projects, all of these, and cash management, all of these can get into the Ether realm and also the Bitcoin realm and begin trading to hedge or to speculate. So let's do a trade illustration, all right? And we're getting towards the end here. We'll do a quick trade illustration, then we'll take a couple of trade illustrations, one spec, one hedge. Ether futures price on January 26th, 1280. Again, this is just an example. Trader buys one February Ether future, ETH, at 1280. The notional value at 1280 is 1280 times 50. That's $64,000. On February 1st, a couple days later, the Ether price is 1300. So you've made 20 points. Well, it's 50 Ether per contract, 50 times 20 points, you've made $1,000. That's the quick way of determining your P&L, or you can do it a long way. If you're new to futures, if you're new to cryptocurrencies, you might want to do it the long one. Just calculate the notional value. So at 1280, the notional value is 64,000. At 1300, the notional value is 65,000. So your notional value increased by 1,000, you made $1,000. Your margin, again, to be determined. I would say, it's trading around $80,000. The margin will be at least 30%, would be a guess. This is a guess. Do not quote me on this. It's a guess. But at least 30%. 30% of an $80,000 contract will be $24,000. It's going to be a big margin. And again, the firm, the FCM, has the right to charge more margin. Back in the days when NASDAQ, before the technology bubble burst in 2000, in March of 2000, the NASDAQ 100, the large pit trader contract, had a $30,000 margin. It was moving 300 points a day. That's incredible. It doesn't even do that now. So it moved 300 points a day, and the margin was $30,000. There are some firms charging $50,000. So it's just to protect the system, protect your customers. You don't want any one customer to have, you know, a position that could put you out of business. And the clearinghouse and the firms together in conjunction with each other make sure that doesn't happen. So you made 20 points times $50, you made $1,000. Margin to be determined. All right, let's go on to a different type of hedge. All right, an Ethereum miner has assembled a nice portfolio of Ether with the large advance in 20 and 2021. The miner would like to lock in some gains and diversify his portfolio with the proceeds, which is usually what people do when they come to do this type of thing. They got a lot of Bitcoin, or they got a lot of Ether, or someone that's got a lot of stock. They have one stock, so they have huge single stock exposure. They want to diversify. That's what the futures market can help you do. So the miner holds 2,000 Ether. Miner wishes to hedge half his holdings. So 1,000 Ether needs to be hedged. So each Ether futures, again, equals 50 Ether. So 20 contracts are going to be required, and he'd be hedging against the decline. Well, when you're hedging against the downside, this is called a short hedge. So you would need to sell short 20 contracts, okay? Also known as short hedge. So selling or hedging would lock in the current price should Ether decline. The profits on the hedge would offset the losses on his Ether portfolio from mining. But if Ether should advance, as it has done in the last couple of weeks, last couple of months, the miner could remove the hedge and reestablish at some point in the future. The thing about hedges, they have to be managed, right? If you're going to use this as a hedging tool, they have to be managed. So if Ether starts to rally dramatically, you're going to have to take your hedge off. You don't want to give up potential profits in the end. All right. So let's turn the page here. So the ecosystem is growing. All right. So the all-time high in Bitcoin and gold correlation was seen at the same time when MicroStrategy, the world's largest business intel firm, they bought $250 million of Bitcoin, making the asset its primary treasury reserve. This is seen as a major sign of institutional interest, according to Cointelegraph there. That was a very gutsy move to put a quarter million of your treasury reserves into Bitcoin. The board must have like had a couple of sleepless nights, but he's more than doubled, almost tripled the money because Bitcoin was at less, I think it was at like 12,000-13,000 when he did it. And we're at 37,000 now. On the right-hand side, it says in a survey done by America's leading money manager, Fidelity Investments, shows a third of large institutional investors owning crypto assets. 3 years ago, when we launched this thing, you couldn't find a pension fund or an endowment or a large money manager with Bitcoin. It'd be hard to do. You'd be hard-pressed. Now it's, again, it's becoming part of the landscape and the ecosystem's growing nicely. And this will contribute to a much more liquid market going down the road as more and more institutions, more and more traders get in and get more critical mass. You're going to have greater liquidity and probably dampen a little bit of the volatility, although you never know. Ecosystems growing for Ethereum blockchain technology too. Google, Comcast, UBS, Fidelity, all the names you see down there, Amazon, MetLife. These people have invested in a lot of blockchain, especially Ethereum. Also, some of the Ivy League schools, the big endowments, they've always been different. Stanford, Harvard, Yale always did something a little different. They don't do the 60-40 paradigm with stocks and bonds. They're into swaps. They're into alternative assets. It's no surprise to me that this report claiming that Harvard, Yale, and Brown University have been discreetly buying Bitcoin. It would not surprise me at all that Stanford, MIT, all these folks, if they haven't bought it, they're seriously thinking about it at some point. Because it's a great diversifier. It's like totally different than anything out there. It'll be very interesting to see my take on this, just a personal opinion, very interesting to see where the regulators will go on this, not only in the United States, but in Asia time zone and European time zone. It would also be very interesting to see the taxing authorities, the IRS, the other taxing authorities around the world. They're the ones that, you know, hold the keys to any potential, you know, should we say, stumbling blocks. That's not the word I'm looking for. Usually they're pretty reasonable, and we'll see what happens. But the landscape is growing. The ecosystem is growing. So as we wrap up here, we're right at 45 minutes. This is good. I want to call your attention to the CME Institute. You can actually go to cmegroup.com/education. We have a lot of online classes. We have a trading simulator. If you've never traded futures before, get on the simulator. Okay. If you've ever flown in an airplane, the pilot that flew that airplane spent thousands of hours in a simulator to learn how to fly under different conditions. You should do the same thing in futures, especially if you're going to trade with real money. If you're going to trade Ether or Bitcoin, get some simulation time. Get some time in the simulator. You'll be glad you did it. It's a great way to give you $100,000 of fake money, calculates your margins, realized gains, unrealized gains and losses. It's a really good way to get an approximation. It's mostly for people that have very little experience, that haven't traded before. It's a very, very good idea to get time on the simulator. We also have classes, online classes, modules, and other tools to help you sharpen your skills. And get your learning curve up to speed. So I want to thank you. And again, I want to thank Ironbeam and Futures.io for lending us speak here. And now by the way, at the appendix here, we have some of the market makers and block providers. So you can see some of the firms there. If you're going to do any appreciative amount of business, you can do this. You can see market makers, block providers. They haven't been finalized yet, but these are the ones would do it with Bitcoin, and we're hopefully going to get them on board for Ether too. And we have some of the FCMs, but you would go through Ironbeam. But these are FCMs that will do all sorts of different, you know, fancy footwork for you and can do EFPs and things like that. So something you want to consider. All right. But thank you for listening. And watch for Ether risk management, or for Ether futures, excuse me, on February 8th. So we'll take some questions now.
So the first question looks like it is, what is the per tick value?
0.25, and that'll equal $12.50. Tick sizes are always in points and in dollars. So 0.25. And that is equal to $12.50.
And the margin requirement?
We don't know yet. That's why I kept saying to be determined. But the margin requirement will probably be very similar in percentage to Bitcoin because the volatilities are similar. Probably be even a little bit more maybe because the Ether volatility has been running ahead of Bitcoin lately because it's moving up and down just the same amount. But it's a $1,600 price base as opposed to $37,000 price base. So the math is a little different.
Right. And then the next one I'm seeing, are there any plans to add a third crypto based on how much money is pouring into the crypto markets so far this year?
That's something the CME Group is always looking at. We're always looking at new products. And I always thought when we did launch Bitcoin that eventually we would have a whole product suite. And this is the natural extension. We have the biggest one, Bitcoin, and now Ether is the second largest of the cryptocurrencies. So it makes sense. What we like to do, though, is develop some core liquidity and then maybe launch options on it. And then when we have good liquidity in the futures and the options, think about other things. But remember, though, you need a large market cap to attract interest. You know, Ether is over 100 billion now. Bitcoin's over 650 billion. So you need a critical mass. You need a certain amount of institutions and traders and speculators and hedgers to help make things more successful.
And I'm noticing that some of the attendees in there, I think they have their like virtual hands raised. If you have a question, just feel free to put it in the chat. One person just asked, how come we haven't seen a mini or micro Bitcoin contract yet? The burning question we get all the time.
Yeah. I'm not so sure I can answer it, but I'm going to take a guess. When it came to the Bitcoin launch, we were watched very closely. You know, regulators were watching very closely because this thing moves so much. They want to make sure that the investing public realizes what they're getting into. And I think we've done a good job of that. The firms have done a good job of it. You know, having large margins does a good job of it and stuff like that. But they wanted us to proceed slowly. You know, we never launched a micro right off the bat anyways in anything. It took, you know, we launched the S&P in 1982. We launched the mini S&P 15 years later in 1997. And we launched the micros in 2019. So it's a natural progression. If Bitcoin were to go to 100,000 or 80,000 or 60,000, and, you know, the contract's 180,000 now approximately, roughly 160,000. I don't know. If it gets to 200,000, 300,000, 400,000 and the margins 50,000, 60,000, yeah, we'd certainly consider it then. But as volatility gets dampened, the margin should go down a little bit. But as far as a micro Bitcoin, I'm not so sure. You know, I can find out and John Bria can get back to you. I'll ask Tim McCourt, who runs the entire equity BLM, and they have the cryptocurrencies underneath them. But, you know, you just have to be careful. You want to bring new traders into the market, but you want to do it at a pace that's, you know, respects the regulators and respects the marketplace. And this market is all over.
My idea would be a smaller Bitcoin contract, but also with slightly less leverage of the big, you know, that could be a measured approach to it.
Mm-hmm. I imagine in the future, you probably would see it because if this thing keeps growing the way it's doing, there's going to be a lot of volume and a lot of activity, and people are going to say, we want in. What about the littler guy or the smaller guy or the less well-capitalized guy that might be sophisticated who just doesn't have can't put up $50,000 in margin? So we're pretty progressive on that. The Merck's usually aggressive in launching new products. I won't say no, but I won't say yes either, but we wouldn't rule it out.
All right, I think there's a couple more in here.
Mike, what platforms will we be able to trade Ether on?
It should be everything we offer. I mean, CQG will have it, so all the CQG platforms, I'm sure, would support it. I don't see there's a reason why they wouldn't. Rhythmic, I'm sure, will have it. Firetip will have it. I think the only other feed would be CTS, which should have it. I think it's mostly just up to us, the FCM, to enable it versus the actual platforms to support it. So as long as there's not any, you know, crazy liquidity issues or something, which I can't imagine there being, you should be able to trade it on any platform we offer. Okay, here's another question here. Do you think the launch of the Ethereum futures could cause a crash as it was for the Bitcoin futures back in 2017? What is your personal opinion on it? Is the context different now?
I love questions like that. If you think that a launch of a futures contract caused a crash, that's very erroneous thinking. Usually when a big move happens in something, you know, the SEC, the CFTC come a knock and they do all sorts of investigations. There was none. There was no investigation. You had a parabolic uprise. You had a major speculative fever. So you're thinking now, the thinking now would be because Ether is launched that you'll have a major correction in Ether. It could be, but I can pick out a whole bunch of futures contracts that were launched at the same time that the market started rocketing upward too. So now look at 1982, April of 82 was a major bottom in the stock market. We started a 20-year run and we launched S&P futures, so we didn't cause a crash there. If anything, it probably, what's the word I'm looking for? Probably made it a little bit more less painful because you had a futures contract that you can hedge against the downside.
Mm-hmm.
So be careful there. You can't say that a futures contract caused a crash in the underlying cash market. We only did it 500 to 1,000 a day in the first few days. By the way, I think it was heading down before we launched the futures contract anyways. It peaked a few days before and then started heading down. Don't quote me on that, though. I don't know the exact dates. By the way, I'm a big fan of RSI. The RSI in Bitcoin was above 90% for the longest time I'd ever seen. I got this question this morning when I did another presentation on technical analysis. The RSI, I almost never see it above 90. I'm sure most of you in the audience, if you look at RSI, very few things get into the mid-80s. This got to 90, 95, and stayed there for a long time. When you get RSIs like that, irrespective of futures contract, you're going to have one nasty correction, which is exactly what happened. And when you have a major parabolic like we did, this is one of the major parabolics in history. There have been six or seven of them. Crash of 29, Nikkei in 1989, the Dutch tulip bulb thing. There's been seven or eight major parabolic uprises. Bitcoin was the latest one. So you usually come down pretty hard after a parabolic uprise. Look at GameStop.
What's that?
What's that? That's the stock that went from 25 to 470 in 3 days.
So someone asked, and I'm assuming you're probably doing it similar to how the Bitcoin is calculated, but how is the reference price for ETH going to work?
Oh, yeah, same way. They take a one-hour time frame, I believe, right around, you know, before 10 o'clock, and they cut it into 5 minutes. And then they take an average during each one of those five-minute periods, all right? And then they average all those together and get your reference rates. So it's very robust. You break down a whole bunch of calculations into little five-minute parcels and then average those. You can go to our website. It has and there's a little video on this. It's only 2 minutes long, worth watching. There's a couple other things on the reference rate and the real-time index that'll give you, you know, the calculation methodology. For those of you that are into that kind of thing, have at it. It's really, it's on our website, cmegroup.com. Just press Ether futures or Ether reference rate in the search box.
And that looks like it's it. If anyone has any more questions, we'll give you a few seconds here to put them in. But I think we covered all of them so far.
Okay. Well, thank you for having us.
Awesome. Thank you, guys. Thank you for the webinar, the information, and for spending some time with us this evening.
Sure thing.